Yeah, thanks for the introduction, Mario. Welcome. So it's a bit sad. This is one of the last talks at WordCamp London. So I'm glad you're here. It's an introduction to unit testing. So the talk will be packed with information, but also I aimed to have beginner entry level knowledge required. So this should be doable at this second day, last hour. Anyway, so before we start with unit testing, let's have a look at three or two related things. So testing in general, what is testing? This is the definition of the ISTQB. This is the International Software Testing Qualifications Board. You don't have to read it, and you should see the slides maybe. Is that? Okay, yeah, so this is the definition of software testing in general. I highlighted three things here. So testing is about planning, preparation, and evaluation of our software. And what we're interested in is if they specify with the requirements. So if they satisfy the requirements. And also, the direct goal is to find defects in the software. So basically, this is a test. We have two things that should match. And at this, it doesn't matter what is the requirement and what is the product that we developed. They should match, and if they don't, there is a difference, and then our test found the defect or the difference here. And if you're wondering, there are five differences here. When we know something is there, we might ask, why is it there? Why should I care? Why should I do something about that? So there are reasons for testing, of course. One is software contains defects, and they hide. These defects may cause failures in our program. Depending on what we're doing with our software, these failures might even kill people, and they definitely can cost you money. So testing our software gives us confidence in the code that we have. So it's confidence in the functionality, but also the quality. So testing does not improve quality, it tells you about the current quality, and then you can do something about it if you have to. But also, when you test and you do it right and you're comfortable in testing, with testing, then this might actually speed up your development process. And there are other reasons for testing. Last thing related to testing, unit testing, is testable code. So if you think about it, every piece of software, every code snippet is testable somehow. So you could, for example, see what's the return value of some function, what's the output that I get. There might be side effects, like I call a function and some other variable in a global space or some other whatever side effect can happen. And also, I start my program and it doesn't crash. This is also some kind of a test. And of course, many more. But this is not what, when you read or hear here, testable code, this is not what this refers to. Testable code is most probably always in the context of unit testing. So it actually means unit testable code. So unit testing is also called, or can be called, component testing or module testing. And basically, it's just one part of the testing landscape. So before we start with what is testing, a unit testing, we have a look at where it is. So this is the V model. I do not want to tell you how to develop software, so this is just one nice overview of all the development phases or things that you can do and will do in the process of developing software. And as you can see, if this works, so unit testing is here, and it has a relation to the module design, which is the component design, the unit design. And then the implementation, this is our software, this is the code. And these things are related to each other. So unit testing is dynamic testing of individual units, and you have to test them in isolation. If you're sleepy, just remember this, and then you're halfway good. So let's now go through these three things step by step. Unit testing is dynamic testing. Dynamic testing means we execute our code. In contrast to that, we have static testing, which just means analyzing or reading the code. Dynamic testing is really about running our software. When there are defects in the software, they might result in failures. The failures have then one or more defects as the as a reason, or as the thing that produced this failure. So we want to debug them, we want to find the bugs, we want to fix these bugs, and then we improved our software quality. And we started with testing our product, our software. Unit testing is about validation. This means we want to see if the requirements are satisfied. And another phrase for this is, are we building the right product? Another thing that has to do with testing, with static testing, is, are we building the product right? And this is really about, is this thing that we're building, does it do what it should do? Unit testing is also white box testing. This is a technique or a collection of techniques, I don't know, for testing. So this means our software, the code snippet that you're testing, is not a black box to you. Actually, white box is the most well-known name for that, but also it can be called glass box testing, and this is really what I want to call it, because you can see through the box and you see the code. This means if you want to design unit tests, you have to have knowledge about the code. So let's say this is a function. I have PHP and JavaScript code snippets, and you can see, if it's not obvious from the code itself, you can see here in the right corner what it is, PHP or JavaScript. So let's say we have this function. This is our subject under test, our function under test, our testy, whatever. And if we want to make sure that this thing is behaving correctly or is behaving as expected, yeah, then we have first to know what is to be expected. And in this simple case, the expectation is this thing returns the string 42. No matter what you can do, I mean, you can just call it, and this will return 42. Okay, defining units. Unit testing is about testing units. So what is a unit? When we start with our code, so the atomic level we have in our code is a character. Combining characters, we can build words. These can be keywords, values, names, it could be operators, and other things. When we respect our syntax rules, then we can combine words into expressions, words and operators and things like that. And then expressions can be wrapped into logic, or they can create logic. For example, conditional logic, mathematics, and stuff like that. When we want to wrap different kinds of logic, then we call this a function or a procedure. And even further, we can encapsulate multiple functions, or also just one function, in a class, or in a module, or in a component, and these things can also contain state. There are, of course, other ways, or other things, other layers above that, but let's think about what we have. So we have characters, we have words, we have expressions, we have logic, and logic is the first thing that you can test. So logic is something should happen. For example, if you multiply 1 by 2, this should result in something. This means actually something, not by it on itself. It's a combination of these things. And also, we can, of course, because logic is contained in functions, we can test functions, and we can test classes and so on. Now, going higher doesn't make sense, because unit testing is about testing the unit, and not only just one unit, but the smallest unit that makes sense to test, that is worth testing, and that can be tested. So, as of now, we think about a unit either as logic, or a function, or a class, or a module. But let's think about logic again. So, in this example, we have 3 times logic. We have a conditional logic, and we have 2 arithmetic expressions. The problem with this is we can test the logic, but we can't test the logic individually. Because, you know, the program runs from top to bottom, at least for the first line, and we will execute this piece of software. We will have this either result in true or false. And if this is true, we will also execute this piece of logic. And if this is false, we execute that. So we cannot test one piece of logic individually. So this means you can test logic, but not as a unit. So a unit is either a function, or a procedure, or a method, or it's a class or module. This is up to us. It's up to you. Now, the third thing, testing in isolation. This is really important, but for some reason, this is also very often overlooked. Testing in isolation also means that you know the reason if a test fails. Why that is, we will see in the next minutes. So just your gut feeling, is this here a unit test? This is taken from the WordPress core tests. Is that a unit test? Who thinks this is a unit test? Raise your hand. Okay. It's not a unit test, at least from what we can think of when reading this. This is because we're having this function, we're having this function, and this is from the name actually what we want to test, but we also call this function and again and another function, so this is not a unit test. This is some kind of integration or system test, but it has every right to exist. It just should also be accompanied with unit tests. So for the remainder of this talk, I will show you unit tests, code examples, and then the unit test, and tell you why we can come up with these kind of tests. So the first thing is these two, PHP and JavaScript versions of the function that we already saw before. So when we inspect that and see what we're having here, basically we have a simple function. We don't have any dependencies. And to test this function, all we need is to have some kind of test framework, a test runner, a unit test framework. These are just a few. For the PHP side, I think PHP unit is the most well-known, of course. For JavaScript, there are really, really many. Not as many as libraries, but there are many. I think Jest is, in the last 1.5 or 2 years, the most well adopted if you start testing right now. And also, I saw a lot of people move from some whatever they had in a running project, not when they started a new project. They actually moved all their tests to Jest. Tape is something that I have been using before because it's really, really simple, and it doesn't give you all the bells and whistles, and you have no idea what to use when. So an example unit test here. Remember, the function just returns the string 42. So we have an expectation. The expectation is we get some value if we call that function, and the value is 42. Why do we know that? Because we have to have knowledge of the code, and it's written in the code, so it's 42. Then we call the function, and then we assert, or we want to make sure, that the expected thing is actually what we get. It's as simple as that. The JavaScript version, I'm using Jest here, is pretty much similar. So we have an expectation, we call the thing, and then we compare these two things. Now, what happens if we do object-oriented programming? So we have the function from before, but we encapsulate that in a module or in a class. So what's new here is we still have that simple piece of code, the function, living in some module. We still don't have any dependencies, which means we're still good with just a unit testing or a testing framework. And this is from before. So in the next code examples, I do not have expected and actual separately because it doesn't fit on the slide anymore. So we have an expectation, and we call. So we create on the fly an object and directly call that method, and we want to make sure that these two things fit together. This is a JavaScript version. The third example. What's new here is we have, so basically there are many things. There are a couple of things new, differently, but they might not have an effect on how we can test or how we have to test. So what's new here is when we just have a look at the function, we take some input. And then inside the function, we might have, or we depending on the input, we do have two flows of the code. So either This thing returns the answer of Oracle, and we have a look at it in a minute, or an empty string. So Oracle is something that we feed into our class. It's dependency injection. It's something from the outside that's being injected into this object, and we're just using that. What's important for unit testing here is we have no idea what this thing will return, and we're not interested in that. We just want to make sure that if we spend enough money, that we return the answer of that Oracle. This is the JavaScript equivalent. It's pretty similar here. In the PHP part, this is actually PHP 7 and beyond code. So we have type hints, scalar type hints as well. And in JavaScript, we do not have it. So we have to cast it. And the logic is pretty similar. So once again, when we inspect it, we have that conditional logic, and we have that external dependency. So what do we do with that? I told you that you have to test your units in isolation, but I did not tell you how to do that. So how can we test something in isolation if there are dependencies? Depending on what material you have, like videos or articles or books, what you have, you might read about mocking. You might read about stubs. You might read about spies, fake, dummy objects, whatever. It's pretty much always referring to something that is just a dummy piece of code, which you can control if you want or if you have to. So what we have to do or want to do here is two things. We have our piece of code, and we want to execute that because we're doing dynamic testing. This means we do not want to have any errors here, which means that if PHP, the parser, finds something that's not there, we will get an error. So we have to make sure that this thing can be ran. But also, we do want to have all the dependencies being fake ones that we can control. So again, we have this conditional thing taking input, and also we have this dependency. So what we're using in addition to the testing framework is a mocking library. Depending on what you use for testing framework, this thing is available in the testing library itself. For example, PHPUnit has built-in mocking capabilities, Jest as well. But you can use something additional, for example, mockery or prophecy for PHP. I don't list JavaScript because in JavaScript, we can just override anything that exists in the global scope. In PHP, you cannot do this that easily. So this is one way to design the PHP test. The first line is just, so I'm using mockery here. The first line is just to make that integration with the PHP test runner and my mocking library. And the test method itself is, first of all, let's start here. We're instantiating an object of the class that we want to test. And then we call the method with zero amount of money, which is not enough because we want to have five or more, and the amount 100, which is enough. So we expect the empty string in the first case. And if we spend enough money, we expect some answer. Now, what is this? Answer is in our test, just a hard-coded string. And then we create with mockery an object that has an answer method, so you can call answer on that object, and it will return you the value stored in answer. So if you think about that, we feed this Oracle thing, it's just a fake object, to our fortune teller. If we spend enough money, this fortune teller should ask the Oracle, should consult the Oracle. And we define how this Oracle thing should behave in our test. So we tested fortune teller in isolation, or not really in isolation, but we did not test any other real thing which might contain defects. As you could see in the example before, we had two times pretty much similar calls. Like we expected something, we called the method, and we passed some input. And sometimes you don't have only two, but even more. So when you use PHP units, you can make use of something that's called a data provider. A data provider results in our test methods being passed some arguments that we define later on. It's here on the next slide. And then we just take this thing that we get passed as an answer, and then we take an expected value that we get also passed, and we put the money that we could also pass into the object. So What you do by using a data provider is you make your test methods pretty simple, and also you separate the test method itself, the test logic, from the configuration of that, like what are you testing with the input and expectation values. This is the data provider. In this case, I just have two different test scenarios. One time, I spend zero money and I expect the empty string, and this is actually not being used, so this is the result that the Oracle should return, but this is not being used in that case. If I spend enough money, the expected answer is the answer of that Oracle. Using JavaScript, it's pretty similar. And here we don't have data providers, but there is an additional library that's called Jest Each. And when using this, you have an array of the input values, and then you call the simple test method. And in this, I'm passing this Oracle thing, and this doesn't change. So in JavaScript, I can easily create this out of this thing, because it has nothing to do with what we feed our testee. It should always behave the same. Okay, fourth example. It's pretty similar to the example two, but we call a function, that's not defined here in our code itself. So in JavaScript, it's a global function. In PHP, it could live in some namespace or whatever. So what's new here is we have this external function. And if you know PHP, it's not easy to just redefine a function, or simply it's not possible to just redefine a function. For JavaScript, it is possible, but still you can make use of dedicated mocking redefinition libraries. For PHP, it is, for example, BrainMonkey or Patchwork, which is being used by BrainMonkey under the hood, but BrainMonkey allows for other things that you will see, so I mentioned that here. And for JavaScript, you can use JestMock or Sinon.js. This is a possible PHP test. So what we're doing here is pretty similar to before. We define a function, not an object. We define a function, and we tell the function how to behave. So this should return answer, which is just this hard-coded string. The assertion is pretty similar to before. But also, what this allows, if we want to do this, we can make sure this function should only be called once, and exactly once. It has to be called, but only once. And also, only if these two arguments are the values that's being called with, then this will return the hard-coded answer. I think by default it's null or something else, empty string, I don't know. And the arguments that we pass in here are up to us. So I could also pass the hard-coded string in the first place, like the answer is 42, for example. This is up to us. Is this really important for the functionality of the code or not? This is a JavaScript version. We have this function living in the global scope. So what we have to do here is, in our test, we have to make sure that it's there, so we just define that, and we use Jest to define this function. And this is important. When we're done, we have to reset that, because this might affect other tests that we're running later on. And then the test itself is pretty similar to before. So we call the thing, and under the hood, it's been using our mocked function. And also, we can make sure that this function is being called once. And in this example, I actually did not have this regex or sum string or whatever. I passed in the answer is 42 dot. So this is up to us. A fifth example is, basically, it is just like before. So we have additional functions. We have do action, we have apply filters. So we could just mock these two functions and decide how they should behave. For WordPress, these are two important functions. If you're developing a plugin, you should make use of these two functions. It's the plugin API, the plugins API. So some nice guy, a former colleague of mine, developed or created a library that can be used for mocking WordPress-related functionality. So with this library, it is BrainMonkey, and there exists another pretty similar library, WPMock. With this library, it's possible to write code like this. So this is our test code. We create an object, we call the method, and we directly can expect something. We did not specify doAction, and we did not specify applyFilters. This has been done by BrainMonkey for us, because this is thought to be used for plugin developers and theme developers. And also, in our test, we can call this function. And what's important here is this is not the WordPress function. This is also being set up for us by BrainMonkey. It behaves exactly like the WordPress function and allows even more. And also, WordPress does have did action, which just means give me the number of times the action hook with that name has been done in WordPress terminology. In WordPress, there is no did filter or applied filter. BrainMonkey has this for us. It's a static, it's a function living in this namespace. So we can also make sure that the filter has been applied once. Sixth and seventh examples are JavaScript, a bit more state of the art. So this is code involving JSX. So we might want to use React, for example. What this thing does is we create basically a list item with data that we pass in, an ID and a text, and then we create it. So what you see here is we have JSX, we do have props that we pass, we have no real dependency except for React that we need to be able to interpret JSX code, which means we might want to use or we have to use a React testing library, for example, one of these three. Then our test could look something like that. So here is the thing that we can create with the function from before. It's actually a component. It's a simple, stupid component. We pass ID, which we set up here. We pass text, which we set up here. And then we use something from React Test Renderer. So we create something from that JSX expression. Then we create a JSON expression from that. And what we can do then is, for example, we can make sure that the type of the node or the HTML element that this JSX expression renders into is a list item. We can make sure that this thing has a class name Oracle Answer. We could, for example, test that ID is somewhere in the children. It is just in a text node and so on. We also have this text here, and if you remember, we had text wrapped in the EM emphasized HTML tag and so on, and this is unfortunate because this is still JSX inside here, and you cannot easily test some regex magic here with JSX. But there is this nice thing called snapshot testing. So what this does is it just renders the whole HTML for you, and that's it for the first time. Every other time that we execute our test method, this thing will get rendered again in memory and compared with the result that we store in a file. So the result of that snapshot is being written to file somewhere, and then if for whatever reason on some call of our test method this does not match with what we had before and what we wanted to have, then we get screamed at. So there's something wrong, please check this. This is, for the simple example, what the snapshot file looks like. So we only had one export case, one scenario in here. So we called this thing with two values, ID and text. Some ID here, some text here, and this is the rendered HTML. And again, if we call it again, and this does not match, then we have to check why that is. Maybe we added some class here. Maybe we do not want to have a colon, but we want to have space, dash, space, whatever. It's up to us to decide if we want to update that or if there's actually something wrong in our code. Last example, this is again a React example. It's not a stupid, or it's not as stupid as before, because what's new here is that we also import some other components. Before, we just rendered HTML, so existing HTML elements. Now we also have this answer thing. This is from example 6. So our React Oracle reads an array of answers and then creates a list with each answer being a list item that you saw before. So we have JSX, we have props, we have also dependencies, so one other component. And if you remember, we want to test this in isolation. So we still use a React testing library, but we have to do something about only using our unit that we want to test, our component in this case. Luckily, there are different testing libraries that have this built in for us. So for example, Enzyme in this case, I could also use the React test renderer from before. I just want to show you different things. Enzyme has a function called shallow for us. What shallow does is whatever JSX expression you feed it, as soon as the function reaches something that is not an HTML, an existing HTML element, but another component, this is not being interpreted. It stays just as it is. So for example, as you can see here, we call our testy, this should be React Oracle, with this array of answers that we created here before, like just two objects, we have an ID, we have a text, and then we shallow render this. The first expectation is this thing should be an unordered list with the class Oracle, and now we loop through all of our answers, so two in our case, we take these two properties, so in the first time we have this object, we take ID, we take text, and now inside of this function we have these two variables. And now we make sure that the wrapper, so this is the whole output that we have, contains an element that is still answer. So we do not want to interpret answer, but we know it's there because we know the code and we have to know the code. And we also know that ID has to be passed and text has to be passed. Actually, all the props that we pass, but this is what we're interested in. And now we loop through this, so actually we have 1, 2, 3 expectations. Okay, so we saw 7 code examples, or actually 14, 12, 15, something like that, because of JavaScript and PHP. So how do you write unit tests, and how do you write good unit tests? There is a great article by Eric Elliott, which basically says that every unit test has the task to answer 5 questions. The first one is what we are testing. The second one is what should it do? So this is really what we expect here. The third one is, what should it do? Yes, and what is, this is wrong, should be actual, sorry. What is the actual result here? Okay, it's this way, okay, so we still have expected and actual. And then also, of course, because tests are some kind of documentation, it's important for us to know how we can reproduce the test. So for PHP, this is a simple template for that. So we have the what split over here, the what class, and the what method. This is what it should do. So for example, return 42, or return the next best thing, or I don't know, something that makes sense for you in plain English. Then we have the expectation. Then we have the actual result. And also PHP units in the assertion method that it has allows you to, for every assertion, specify some message that if this thing fails, you will see in your output. So this is, again, what should it do here if you want to use it here as well. So where's the fifth answer? It is also the actual thing. It is basically what we have here and everything that's related here. So if we call a function with some argument that we set up before, all of this is how we can reproduce the test. This is the JavaScript variant. So We're using this describe and test, or if you want describe and it functions here. What we're testing, what should it do, expected result, actual result, and this is also what we define here, how to reproduce. So the takeaways from this talk, hopefully, are unit testing aims at finding defects. We're on a code level here. It is about executing the code, so it's dynamic testing. We're testing units per unit, so we're testing them individually. And we have to have full knowledge of the code. And also, the result of this, or the actual implicit goal is, yeah, we want to make sure that the software works. If you want to read about that, the slides are online. These are articles about unit testing. And now I guess there's maybe time for some questions if you're still awake. Thank you.
Thank you, Thorsten. I already see one question right here.
Thank you for the time, that was really helpful. My question is, how do you do this when your function echoes something or outputs some content out to the buffer?
Yeah. This depends on your testing library. For example, PHPUnit has expectations for output. So this, under the hood, calls or uses output buffering. And you can just, yeah, create some expectations against the output. It's possible. Yeah.
Any further questions?
Yeah, they are. So if you want, we can later on meet somewhere, I can show you. So you mean more PHP or more JavaScript or both?
PHP.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, they are. Do you want to have OOP examples? Or I think I only know good OOP.
Yeah, sure.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Any other questions?
It's late.
Well, there's one.
When you create a snapshot, can you sort of pre-sanitize it to cater for different differing results, for example, date stamps or something like that?
I'm not sure what you mean with sanitize, because it depends on what the actual code is that you're executing, and then if you want or if you can manipulate that. Because if your code creates a date, timestamp, whatever, then this is what this thing should do.
Yeah,
right?
I might not care about the timestamp itself, it's the other data that's more important.
I mean, there are different ways to use these snapshots. So for example, you don't have to create one snapshot from the whole thing that your unit is. You can create snapshots from everything that can have a string representation. So for example, you can create a snapshot from a JavaScript object. You can create a snapshot from just a string or something like that. So you don't have to use snapshots only. And also, they don't replace unit testing. They give you, for some components or for some things that you want to test, they give you this nice thing that you just want to execute. Check it once, so check the snapshot file. If this is what you want, then you don't have to do anything until the testing library says, hey, there's something wrong, please check. And it's up to you to decide if that makes sense and for what kind of data that makes sense or not.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody, for your attention. Thank you, Thorsten.
You're welcome.